Вітаю вас, браття, сестри, любов'ю Господу нашого Ісуса Христа. Я чесно визнаю, що мені звідси набагато краще на церкву дивитися, ніж із Зума. Тому з Зуму здається, що...
Greet you, brothers and sisters, with the love of our Lord, Jesus Christ. It is much more convenient for me to look at the church from this place. But it is a quarantine, and we appeal to everybody to take care of themselves and to fulfill all the rules, regulations, to put on masks, to wash hands, and if you have possibility to stay at home, next time we plan to meet in this hall again. So far, we do not have any warnings from powers or from the management of this church. But I understand that while the public transport does not operate, it will be harder. At the beginning, I would like to deviate myself from my sermon and to share a thought which is just very important for our church. After yesterday's Bible study, I had this thought. It is related to the to the issues which we constantly ignore. It's the relations between men and a woman. We had three sermons already which said husbands love your wives and wives fear your husbands. But I have different focuses. We have different focuses from those sermons. And I had a thought from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 21, be subduing yourself in fear of God. And I thought, if there is, we understand that there is a hierarchy, woman, man, Lord, but my attention was drawn to the commentary, so to this verse, so be subdued to one another. I had thought before that women have to be subdued to men and children to parents and we all to Lord, but here to one another it is in double direction. And I thought, how is that? When we read this verse, we saw yesterday
that підкоряючись, це, мабуть, неправильне слово. Його треба прибрати.
To be subdued, it is not maybe a right word. It should be deleted because we live in a free country. How can we be subdued? And maybe we have to be to respect, to appreciate one another. Maybe the translation was wrong, and then we have taken comment, and we... the word which is used there was meant in situation describing soldier obeying general or slave obeying his master. That is obeying without any objections. And then we saw a cultural comment. And we saw that those times the society was tuned to quite differently. The hierarchy was very strict, and for example, there is a master and there is Слейф, for example, could not even think about not ruling. the wives and the servants, the whole state of that time, because that was only in that culture, humbleness was only for slaves, obedience was only for slaves. And I agree with the comment, which means that I do not want my wife to obey me only because she is a wife. I don't want such obedience. We obey God not because He is strong and can beat us, but because it goes from heart. It is Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. And we shall obey one another even if it goes against our culture. Submitting to one another in the fear of God. It means that sometimes we have to hold our tongue. If a person says something which says something, don't think that you are head of the family and therefore you should not listen to your children, for example, or to your wife. It does not mean that you should always obey to whatever they say, but give them the possibility
to share and sometimes agree with them, and does not depend on whether a person is great or small. It contradicts what says to us
antique literature or non-biblical Hebrew wisdom. Submitting to one another, submitting is a form of verb which shows that it is not the main word in this sentence. But what is the main word in it? Where it starts from. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Humbleness and seeking wisdom, where you sometimes did not think that the wisdom is there, is a sign of sanctity and being filled with the Spirit. Somebody told me that I was filled with Spirit and I felt very great. And what are the fruit of Holy Spirit, joy? All fruits of Holy Spirit cannot come without humbleness. You should not only be a head and make others humble. But Jesus teaches us to fulfill our obligations and to listen to everybody, to one another. And now the sermon. Another thought which I wanted to share is, how can we call what we do here? We have gathered. What ideas do you have? Worship? Very often they say ministry to God. Why do we help here? Do we come here to minister to God? But in what way? When we say to Him how great He is, when we glorify Him, when we fulfill what He says us to do, when He is the focus of our ministry to God, and please think about it, and think that every day in the week you work and do something, and now on Sunday I come here, and how can I minister? And today I will talk about worship to God. Let's open Luke. Luke chapter 19. From verse 1, let's pray first.
Our
Lord, I thank you that you have given us the Word of God. Please, Lord, put it in our heart and print it in our heart for the reading of that to cause desire in us to worship you and to submit to you, and to see glory, great glory in that. We ask, let this sermon do that. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him, and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when they saw it, they all murmured, saying, he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Amen.
You know,
when this time I studied this extract, the first which drew my attention is the words of people.
Вони нарікали, кажучи, навіщо зайшов він, щоб зупинитися в грішній?
They rebuked, saying, why he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner?
Чому він іде не до добрих? Чому він
спостерігає? You never asked the question why he goes not to kind people, why he saves drug addicts, prostitutes, people who are evil, who are greedy. Why doesn't he come to good people?
Немає хороших людей, всіх спасти. Дуже правильна відповідь. І я з ними погоджуюся, і фактично відповідь у нас вже є, але я хочу все ж таки...
There, because there is no good people in the world. It's the right answer.
Уявимо собі ту ситуацію.
I agree, but I would like to expand on that. Imagine the situation, Jericho. There are people, rich people live here, and there is a customs house there, and a lot of goods pass there through, and there is a castle of Herod there, and it's about 30 kilometers from Jerusalem, that is 17 miles. Jesus goes to Jerusalem, and we know why he goes there, to be revealed to people there, to die, to be killed there. And he passes through a beautiful place. And, if you pass through a beautiful place, maybe you would not impose yourself on anybody to receive you as a guest. For example, we have a beautiful district in Kyiv, Pechersky and Lipki, and they have even gates there, and not anybody can come into that district, because when rich people live somewhere, they want to surround themselves with something beautiful, and they do not want to meet anything non-beautiful. Imagine Zacchae, a person who is short. Imagine that I came across a comment that the average the average height of people in that place and at that time was 1 meter 50 centimeters, but he was even shorter. And very often, maybe he jumped and did not see anything behind people, but he was smart and he decided to do his best to see Jesus. Maybe he had only one chance, and he understood that he was short and all other people were very tall, 1 meter and 50 centimeters. Maybe a person of 1 meter 85 centimeters was a giant at that time there, but beforehand, as a practical person, he ran up ahead of everybody and climbed a tree, a sycamore tree. It was sort of a palm, and he thought, I'm the smartest. You just walk there, and I'm like in the first row of a theater. I will see everything, even sitting. And then he was very surprised when Jesus told him, passing by, Zacchae, and I think that he could have fallen off the tree. It is not written everywhere that they knew one another, that they had known one another, that they had been friends, but for many people it could be like a prophecy that he, that Jesus knew the name of this person just looking at him. And he says, now I must stay at your house. Today I must stay at your house. What Jesus did? Jesus ruined
the
stable perception of stereotypes in that society. He imposes himself to be a guest in somebody's house. That was a rich town, a rich city. It was not normal to be like Winnie the Pooh there and to ask, can I be a guest in your house, or I must stay at your house today. It was not normal, but everybody knows that he talks to Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus was collected taxes.
Taxes
is a normal affair
for
society, but due to many circumstances, people do not like tax collectors. And moreover, he was a tax collector for the Romans. That is, he dealt with dirty money and he dealt with dirty people, with unclean money and unclean people. And he himself was not considered clean, and therefore people could not even address him, communicate with him. And now a person whom people consider to be a prophet communicates to him. He ruins a perception of people about whom to visit and whom to not, and who is kind and who is good and who is bad. He just ruins these stereotypes. Why he does that? Why? I think that we ask this question, though we know more, but those people, they know less. So they had even a greater question about that. They asked why he's a guest with a man. He has got to be a guest with a man who is a sinner, but the answer is not quite simple. Not that Jesus loves sinners here, he wants to save them. No, the answer is much deeper. And in order to understand it, I advise to read the chapter before that and the verses which are written after that. We will not read it now, but we just describe that in chapter before that, there was a parable about an unvirtuous judge, about a woman coming to a judge and asking for the same things, and judge says, I do not fear God, but she pesters me, and I will do what she asks for me. And in that way, Jesus ruins stereotypes, and he shows that it's the nature of God to answer people, not because they are good, but because they ask him, because they keep asking him. And another parable is about Pharisees, that two people have come to synagogue, to temple to pray, and one approaches and says, thank you God that I am not as bad as this tax collector, but who was Zacchaeus? He was a tax collector. Jesus says,
And
Jesus breaks stereotypes. He shows that God treats people differently than we think. He likes more than that for a person to have contrite a heart than for a person to ask, because a person thinks that that the person is worth it. Somebody brings children to bless, and people started to rebuke and say it's meaning that it is for serious gathering, for serious people. Sometimes I have the same thoughts. And struggle with that. I just imagine how they were irritated. And Jesus says, It is important, young adults, men with beards, listen to me, but when children come to me from their early age, it is very important, I once read a story about a church growing in the region of Moscow. The cave was already more or less Christian, but in the territory of Moscow, there was not Christianity, and Greeks decided to send two people there, but those people were killed, and some of them were cast out of the city. And one person, a Greek Christian, settled there near Moscow, and he cooked and shared food with people, and his first visitors were children. Sometimes the children, they understand more than their fathers. This is breaking of stereotypes by Jesus. We think that in order to come to God, one has to be a serious adult man with a beard, but Jesus shows that in order to do that, one has to accept and perceive the word of God. Then there was a story about a rich young man, he asked, what shall I do in order to be saved? Imagine how to do it, and this stereotype of that time and culture, and they asked him who can be saved, then, because the stereotype was that if the God blesses person, the person is rich, and if a person is not rich, the disciples of God said, Lord, we have given up everything and followed you, but it is another stereotype. You think that if they have given up everything for God, they can claim the reward from God. And here is the key, who has not given anything to Jesus, but he just wanted to see him. And when he visited him, something changed in his heart, in the heart of Zacchaeus. What happened to Zacchaeus? He suddenly said, I will give up half of my riches to people. He did not say that he would give away all his riches. But Jesus told him that he is saved. It does not, if to combine all of these, to these parables, it does not mean that we have to give up everything for salvation, but we have to give up our heart. And then Zacchaeus says, if I offended somebody, I will give up more. And if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I'll restore fourfold. it was more than was required by law. He said by that, that I will give much more than is required by law. And those who studied the cultures there, they said that also
you have to give up twofold,
but the Zacchaeus had a spontaneous desire to give up fourfold, and Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house. Let us study this salvation. Did Zacchaeus seek salvation? I do not know, but at least Luke does not tell us that Zacchaeus in good faith gave up one-tenth of his tithe, that he prayed, that he searched salvation. No, on the opposite, he said that Zacchaeus was a sinner, that he was a tax collector, and that he even offended somebody. And, Bible witnesses that Zacchaeus did not search, had not searched God hard, but Jesus searched him. Somebody says that Jesus felt that Zacchaeus wanted to see him, and he reacted to them. But I think there's more to that than that. He responds to the question, why do you come to a sinner? And he answers to us also, to our questions. Question, why do you come to a sinner? And Jesus answers,
а що він каже, сьогодні завітало спасіння до цього дому, бо він
the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. And he also says, today salvation has come to this house. He refers to Abraham, because to Abraham it was promised that all the nations would be blessed in him. Especially it was promised to him that the descendants of Abraham would have special relations to, with God. And in the Old Testament, in Ezekiel, it is said that people at that time did not care about Jewish nation, and Jewish nation went anywhere, and Lord told them, I put to you priests, teachers, but you wander everywhere, but I take care of you, I take care even about these Zacchaeus, who is the worst people in the world by your measures, by your perception, but I take care of him. Because God promised to save him, because God loves even those who go astray. If now you have gone astray and you think that you do not know where to go, know that God loves each one who has gone astray of the right way, and who is and God loves them, it's his purpose. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. And we have to be encouraged by that, because even if you're in the worst state now, even you do not feel God, even you do not feel that he helps you, Jesus to save you. And Jesus Christ wants to sit near you, to visit you, and invite him, and he will not reject you. If he has not rejected the unclean person judged by everybody, he will not hold himself to hide, to come into your heart. And it is written, I stand and knock, and if one opens to me, I will come in and have supper with him. If you are tired of being alone and of not having heard God for a long time, invite him. He will react as he has reacted to Zacchaeus, and he will teach you, and he will have supper with you, dinner with you, and you will be together. And it is also very important to look at how Jesus defined salvation. How we define salvation? Who is saved? Who is a saved person? How do we know that my neighbor or me or somebody else is saved? Very often people hope to be saved. Jesus... Jesus repaired Zacchaeus in such a way that Zacchaeus decided and said to give up money. Something has happened in his heart. He has not stopped to be rich. I even do not know if he stopped to be a tax collector. Maybe even his income did not change, but God touched his heart. And on that basis, a person starts to act how God wants him to act. People have were used to earn something from God. At least they had this thought, you should be a good person or a Pharisee and not a tax collector. And to read the word of God diligently, and in such a way you will earn something from God. Or disciples who told Jesus, we have given up everything and follow you, and what we will have for that. But the true salvation is when a person does something not in order to earn something from God, but because he or she is thankful to him for what God has done for that person. We sit here because once Jesus had to be hung on the cross and he suffered greatly, he has come from heaven, come down. You cannot imagine what sacrifice he has given for us to be able to sit here and to read the word of God and to be Christians and to have hope for the kingdom of God. It's him who has done it. For our heart to be alive and for us to start acting. By the way, it is written there further. We will not go into depth.
Але з 11-го вірша.
But from verse 11, the following words start. Now, as they heard these things, he spoke another parable, because he was near Jerusalem.
Тобто, коли він це розказав, що він Бог прийшов знайти грішників, знайти
що said that he as a God has come to find sinners.
And
you know what he said, a parable, and this parable was about a king who has put different people and gave to them different talents. 10 talents to one person, and 5 to another person, and 1 to another person. One has come to me. I am returning to you 10 more, and he said, well done. I give you 10 towns to rule over them. The same was about another person who said who was with 5 talents.
The third person said,
I did not do anything, but just hid your one talent. And the Lord was very had a lot of wrath against that person. But how can we imagine, how can we connect this with the story about Zacchaeus? It means that if you have a possibility to do something good, do it for God. Even if you do it not quite correctly, the worst thing which you can do is sit down, just sit and think that I am saved. That is it. Maybe Zacchaeus did something not correctly, but it was exactly that salvation was in his heart. Maybe he did not understand all details. For example, he said, I will give up half of my riches, not all my riches, but the most important what was in his heart now. And he did the actions which pleased to God. Now, some people do something in order to please God, and to earn something for that, and others do something because they realized what God has done for them. The first kind of people is those who still seek salvation, and the second kind of people is those who are already saved. They come to Christ not to gain something from him through faith, because we understand that he has given up everything for us already. It reminds me of my talks to people who organize meetings in Kiev. Kiev is a place of meetings of different kinds, good and bad, and I have seen a lot of them. Sometimes they come and start conversations with people there, asking them, of what are you voting for here? For example,
куди люди приходили на мітинг і клали туди 200, 300, 500, 600 гривень.
And so very often I see meetings where people put money, 500 hryvnias, for example. They are not paid to come to the meeting, but they invest money for the sake of some purpose. And these kinds of meetings, they last more than those meetings where people come to earn money. Let be people not those people who come to meeting to earn money, but people who come for cause. And here we come and gather to minister to God, not to gain something, but to give up to God. And the best thing which we can give to God is a heart of gratitude. And let us pray.
Господи, я дякую тобі.
Lord, I thank you.
Приходиш до грішника.
That you come to a sinner, that you come to those who do not to deserve that. You come to those who seek something good for themselves and do something, some bad things, but you come and give very much. You give your life, your attitude, your fellowship. I glorify you and our Holy Father who has come to find those who were lost. Let glory be to you in our hearts and in our lives, always to you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.